Since the first rockets, the first German V2 rockets up to the SpaceX Falcon Heavy, we've seen them working with a bell-shaped nozzle, but their widespread use doesn't mean that they're the best way to do things. In fact, they have a significant drawback, which is one of the reasons why we use multi-stage rockets. To replace the space shuttle, a new generation of single-stage to orbit spacecraft was to be powered by an alternate rocket engine developed in the early 1970s. But if it's so good, why hasn't it even been launched? Sit tight, because you're about to find out. The engine in question is the Aerospike, whose conception dates back to ROCKETDYNE'S initial work in the 1950s. The Aerospike, despite sounding like an exotic new form of propulsion, is just a new way to contain and control the thrust that any rocket powered by liquid or solid fuel produces, and takes the role of a bell-shaped combustion chamber. We've been utilizing bell-shaped rocket nozzle combustion chambers since the earliest rockets, so what's the problem? Well, for starters, it is necessary to manage the burning of rocket fuel for a rocket to function properly and provide enough thrust to launch it into space. Without a rocket nozzle, burning rocket fuel would spread wildly in all directions and produce very little thrust, as the force would be dispersed. The rocket nozzle transforms the high-pressure combustion of the rocket fuel into a very fast gas flow that leaves the nozzle in one direction and at atmospheric pressure. The narrow end to broad end ratio of the nozzle must take the operating environment's air pressure into account. We know it sounds complicated, but it's actually simple. As the air is drawn down by the Earth's gravity, everything, including us, the ground, and rocket engines, is subject to atmospheric pressure, which presses on us from all sides. The mass of a column of air measuring 1 square inch in the region from sea level to the top of the atmosphere is 6.67 kilograms. However, if you were to go up to 12 kilometers, that pressure would be just 1/10 of sea level, and at 50 kilometers, it would be just 1/100 of sea level, because the column of air is now much shorter and therefore weighs much less. Because we evolved to live under that pressure, we don't feel it. The gases ejecting from the rocket nozzle are also pushed by that air pressure. The gases leaving the nozzle must be at atmospheric pressure for the rocket to operate most effectively and generate the greatest amount of thrust. Consequently, they must leave the nozzle as straight as possible. This is acceptable if our rocket is flying diagonally through the atmosphere, much like an air-to-air missile, because little change in air pressure will occur. But a rocket entering orbit experiences high sea level air pressure and zero air pressure in space. A bell nozzle's maximal efficiency and thrust can only be attained at one height because of its fixed size and form. If we design it so that it could take off with the most thrust possible at sea level. Because of the lack of air pressure at higher altitudes, the exhaust gases will overexpand and lose thrust. Design the rocket to produce its greatest thrust at higher altitudes, because as it takes off, the air pressure restricts the gas flow inward, causing it to separate from the nozzle wall and become unstable and, in most cases, explode. In a perfect rocket nozzle, it would alter its shape in response to variations in air pressure and altitude. An Aerospike achieves the same result as a conventional rocket engine's bell by using the air's pressure around it. Aerospikes have been developed in two basic categories, linear and toroidal. Instead of firing the exhaust out of a small hole in the middle of a bell, an Aerospike engine avoids this random distribution by firing along the outside edge of a wedge-shaped protrusion, the spike, which serves the same function as a traditional engine bell. This wedge or spike shape is how they acquired their name, the Aerospike. While the air pressure around it compresses the exhaust against the inner spike, this spike becomes one side of a virtual bell, but many utilized a truncated spike that was far shorter than the comparable bell design. The shape of the exhaust flow changes as a result of the changing air pressure as the rocket transitions from takeoff at high air pressure to low pressure at high altitudes to maintain its optimal thrust. An altitude compensating rocket nozzle is what this is. It performs better than a bell at all other altitudes. The orbit shuttle's main engines, which were utilized to launch into space, were significantly less efficient at sea level than in space, contributing to the necessity for additional boosters during takeoff. However, with a rocket engine like the Aerospike, you may skip the requirement for numerous stages with different rocket engines and utilize just one engine that will operate effectively. So why aren't these being used if they're so good? Even though aerospike technology underwent extensive research and development in the 1960s, 1970s, and again in the 1990s, no significant rocket launch has used it as of yet. Rocketdyne set about developing and producing both the toroidal and linear aerospikes using the turbo pumps and engine architecture of the J2 as a follow-on to the successful J2 engine that was utilized on Saturn's third stage. The cooling of the spike is one of the main issues with aerospike engines. The spike is lengthy and heavy in a toroidal or spherical shape, making it challenging to cool the spike's tip and prevent melting. This was mostly resolved with the invention of a new copper alloy called Narloy Z in the 1970s, which permitted use at high temperatures for extended periods. To accomplish the same outcome as the long spike with less mass, the design was modified to include a truncated spike and some exhaust gases would be able to go through the middle. The linear variant had a more adaptable design though. In this, the combustion chambers are on either side of a circular spike that has been straightened out into a V shape. The beauty of this design is that it allows for the addition of more combustion chambers to create longer, more powerful engines. In the 1970s, combustion nozzles were manufactured in small banks and placed one above the other on each side of the V center. Aerospikes were suggested for the space shuttle, but when the Apollo program was terminated in the early 1970s, work on the aerospike's development also came to an end. As a result, the space shuttle continued to use a standard bell engine nozzle. Nothing changed for the next 20 years until NASA decided to create the next generation space shuttle using a brand new single stage to orbit architecture. The goal of the design brief was to create a new launch vehicle that could be completely reused and would significantly lower the cost of entering space from $10,000 per pound to $1,000 per pound. The X-33, a groundbreaking aircraft whose usage of linear aerospike engines was one of its primary features, was built by Lockheed Martin after winning the contract to build it. The XRS-2200 linear aerospike engine's development work was ongoing, and by this point the usage of electromechanical nozzles made it possible to regulate the fuel system nozzle by nozzle. This eliminated the need for bulky, complicated engine gimbals and enabled considerably more throttle control as well as torque vectoring by turning off certain engine components. The project was well underway up until 2001, when it was abandoned along with the aerospike engines due to problems with the X-33's composite fuel tank and cost overruns. NASA tested small-scale solid rockets using a full-length toroidal aerospike in 2004. However, no big aerospike engine development has taken place since then. With all the efficiencies these engines provide, wouldn't they be a cheap means to space? Why don't new businesses like SpaceX and Blue Origin adopt aerospike engines? As far as we know, SpaceX has considered employing aerospikes, but doing so would be extremely risky if you wanted to start a commercial orbital space enterprise because no large-scale aerospikes have ever been flight-tested. While the methods used by SpaceX and others to employ their technology may differ, such as relighting the primary engines to return to Earth, the engines themselves are a known quantity. Undertaking a significant project like creating a novel engine design without any prior testing would quickly reduce revenues for commercial businesses. It all comes down to time and money. The technology is still in its infancy and requires further refinement. They still have problems with a reduction in thrust in the Mach 1.5 to Mach 3 speed range, and they are more expensive to produce than conventional rocket engines. It would necessitate a full redesign of the rockets to get away from the tried and true but constrained conventional Bell nozzles. All of that takes time. Time that could have been spent launching conventional engines and raising capital for the businesses. Although there could be a 40% fuel savings, the fuel is the least expensive component of the rocket launch. According to Elon Musk, the Falcon 9 costs $60 million to manufacture, but only $200,000 to fuel. More money is saved by bringing back the boosters and central core along with the engines than by switching to aerospikes. It appears that aerospikes won't become a reality until the cost of launches is as low as conventional Bell nozzle engines will allow. Although smaller businesses like Arca Space work on small-scale aerospike engines for single-stage to orbit satellite launches, only time will tell whether aerospikes will ever be used for future spacecraft.